I was 11 years old when I first met an orphan. And in my culture in Ukraine, orphans were always the cast out, the rejected ones, the neglected, the dangerous ones to be around with. And so when I met an orphan for the first time, I didn't know she was an orphan, she was just a girl. And she was an interesting girl to me. And her name is Vera, which means faith. And so we started talking. We talked for probably an hour, maybe more. And at the end of our conversation, I asked her where she lives. And she didn't want to tell me at first. And I thought that was kind of odd. I said, well, why don't you come to my place to hang? We'll just, you know, continue this friendship. I was 11 at the time. So, you know, I just wanted to have another friend who was interesting. And she said, they won't let me out. And I'm thinking, who's not gonna let you out? Your parents, they've gotta be strict, you know? And then I said, well, what about me? Can I come over to your place? And she said, no, no, they won't let you in. So her story, just that mystery, kinda interested me even more. And then at the end of our conversation, she finally broke out and just said it. And she said, I'm an orphan. With this attitude, expecting me to never talk to her again, expecting me to turn around and walk away. And I said, okay, well, where's your orphanage? See, because at that time, I already knew her before I knew her status. And I loved who she was. She was an interesting girl. I didn't care about the title or the status she carried. And so I said, I'll come over to your orphanage. Where is it? And so that was my first time. Next day, I went to see her, which I knew, you know, then she was an orphan. And so I went to see her in an orphanage, and I discovered that there was, you know, hundreds more of them. And I just spent time with them. I shared my life. They asked me questions, the very simple questions about life. And so that kind of captured my heart. And I remember this one time, the first time I got into her little bedroom that had 30 beds in the room. It's not a bedroom we, you know, think about. It's a bedroom with many other kids in there, no privacy. And so all these kids are getting into the bedroom and staring at me. And I'm asking Vera, I said, Vera, what are they coming here for? And she said, well, they're here to hear you. They don't have visitors. We never had visitors here. And I'm like, well, what am I supposed to tell them? I'm just here to see you. I don't have much to share. And she said, don't worry, we'll ask you questions. And so they started asking me questions of just simple everyday life. Does your mom tell you she loves you? Does your mom cook breakfast for you? Does she kiss you before you go to bed? Does she spend time with you? Is your dad protecting you when you're being abused or neglected? And I'm like, well, my family is awesome, but it also sucks at times. And I shared the reality of my family, which was just transparency for them and the sincere relationship at 11 years of age, right? And at that moment, I knew that I knew that I knew that God had called me to minister to orphans, to share what I had to offer. I didn't have to have a special way for God to tell me and speak to me through prophets or preachers and have a confirmation. I knew it was something God called me to do. So I kept going back, and I started a Sunday school within that orphanage. And then I realized that there's more than one. So I went from orphanage to orphanage and started to have a bigger team of volunteers and friends and ministers. And it kind of grew into this massive ministry today. So I was 18 when I wanted to adopt for the first time. Well, actually I was 17, but legally you have to be at least 18 in this country. And so I was 17 when I wanted to adopt, and this boy Max, he was 13. He was in a rehab center for kids who were really difficult, lived on the streets, were tough and knew how to survive. And he was just one of those boys. He used to sniff glue. I pulled him out of a manhole. And he had a plastic bag on his head that was kind of glued onto his hair, and we had to kind of shave it all off, and it was just a mess. But I pulled him out and I said, God, look at this. I mean, why are you trusting this one to us? What are we supposed to do? And he so simply said, just love him. And so I wanted to love as much as I could, as much as I knew how to love. So that was something radical. But you know, the legal aspect of it isn't what was important to me or Max. What was really important and valuable and critical is that he now had a family. He had hope. He had a place where he could say, I belong. He was safe. He was rescued. He was literally pulled out of a dark place and into a bright future. Today, Max is actually a father to two kids, beautiful kids. One is disabled, but he's a dad. And you know, he's married and I married them. He also married an orphan girl, Vika. And the thing about him and each orphan is that orphans, I mean, all they know is temporary. Temporary family, temporary facility, temporary directors, temporary missionaries, temporary everything. And here he, for the first time, had something that was permanent, me, family. And now for me to see that he is family and is a father who's not abandoning his kids, the cycle isn't repeating anymore. Orphans are not making more orphans, they're becoming parents, they're becoming family. In Ukraine, we have a lot of orphans that are registered, but more that are not registered and have a status of an orphan. And the crisis in Ukraine, or the term that people use is crisis, it's the statistics that scares even the locals, because what happens is this cycle of orphans, having more orphans, it keeps on repeating. Simply because the society, our nation, isn't brave enough, doesn't have the mentality, doesn't have the revelation, or whatever it is, to accept them for who they are, and to teach them, and to train them, and to educate. What we do in this society and in this nation is we push them even further away. If you're an orphan, you don't get to go to a good school. If you're an orphan, you don't get to have a good job. And the cycle keeps on repeating because they do all those bad things that society knows them for. They commit crime, they end up in prostitution, human trafficking. They make terrible choices, but it's only because there is nobody to tell them that there is better life, that there is better things for them, that there is hope, and you can make better choices. And so this lifestyle and cycle keeps on repeating. But the reality is for these orphans is that once they graduate an orphanage at the age of 15 or 16, all they have known their whole life up until this point was security, safety. Government provided a place for them to live. Government would cook for them. Government would clean for them, make their beds, tell them when to read the book and do their homework and go to school and tell them when to go to bed and shower. All of these simple things, everyday things, were being told to them. So in a way, that control that the government provided in a facility was their safety about tomorrow. But once they graduate, literally overnight, their life changes. They have this pure freedom that they have no idea what to do with. They were never taught to spend money. They were never taught to make their own decisions. They were always told what to do. So overnight, their life is flipped upside down, and it's a scary place to be. So once they've tasted that freedom, they definitely make terrible choices and end up in prison, crime, prostitution, human trafficking. The cycle keeps repeating itself because then they have kids that they never wanted or planned on having, and they abandon them all over again. And so that's where I believe God wants to have His way and His intervention and break the cycle of rejection, abandonment, and abuse, where we step up as people who love the Lord and who can love His people, His orphans, His children, and love them like He does. And I believe that's how the cycle is going to be broken. The society fears the unknown. And that's, I would say, the biggest struggle for us as Christians and us to minister, those that minister in this nation. It's the mentality we're fighting. It's the mentality that doesn't change overnight. Yes, you can give them everything they want, and you can provide for them, and you can love them, and you can give them a degree, but the society is still afraid of the unknown, and they don't know where an orphan lives. They don't know what they're gonna do next. And that frightens them. And so because of that legal issue still within our nation, where they are literally stamped as an orphan and branded as that and have a social status, of an orphan, that kind of stops them from succeeding and dreaming. And so the hope dies really quickly within their lives. True Hope Ministries is mainly focused today to serve the teenagers, the orphans who aged out from the facilities, from the orphanages, and we still build relationships with little kids and babies even. We minister to those. But our main goal and desire to serve the unwanted. And when they grow up to be teenagers, you know they are not easy. You know they're gonna make terrible choices and they're gonna be brutal with everybody around simply because they were hurt. And hurting people are hurting people. And that's where they're at. So our ministry is to serve them and love them as much as we can. Do everything in our power, and what's beyond our power, we trust the Lord to help us. And what we do is, when they're graduated from a facility, an orphanage or a boarding school or a rehab center, whatever it is, at the age of 16, they really don't have a place to live. They have to go to a dorm and study at a tech school. The only reason they're allowed to live at a dorm, only if they study at a tech school. If they drop out or are kicked out, they live on the streets. And that's not a life that brings hope or gives them hope. So we step in and we serve. We provide apartments, which we call transitional housing, where we train them how to live independent life, where we teach them how to live life on their own. How do you cook? How do you clean? How to wake up on time and make it to school on time and get a job, and how to behave in an interview. They simply don't know how to talk to people who aren't orphans because they have the fear that they're going to be rejected again. They have this fear that they're not going to be accepted, that they're not going to be loved, that they're not going to be valuable. And so that's our ministry. We teach them how to live life within society to the fullest. Right now, True Hope is renting 28 apartments around the city as transitional housing for these teens and young adults. And we've noticed that it's really hard for us to have them all spread out around the city. And it's hard to kind of know what their everyday life is because there's so many of them now. God's vision was that He just put in our hearts to purchase a building that will house all of them at the same time. Not another facility, but a home where they can be trained and taught and loved and are still gonna be in a house or an apartment, sharing a room with someone who's gonna be teaching them, a volunteer or a minister, who's gonna be teaching them how to live life. And so it will be a lot easier for us to have them under one roof because that way we can kind of oversee a little more and help a little more and care more and just be there for them, literally 24/7. Not just to control their lives and tell them what to do, but to offer a better life by being there for them. And if they need help, which they often do, they just come to us. Some of our victories are, well, you know, there's a lot of victories that I want to share, but there's more of bad things that happens every day that you don't want to share. And I once had someone ask me a question, how come you only share the good stories? And my answer was, because bad stories don't encourage us. They usually discourage us. And here is the good that God is doing. Bad always happens. This world is filled with evil. But the great stories that we have is one of my sons, his name is Alexei. I adopted him a while back. And he grew up on the streets. He lived on the streets. He was a tough kid, man. He was big and muscular, and he knew how to survive and how to fight for life. And one night I got a call from a girl, an orphan girl who was in trouble and who needed help. And I said, okay, I'll come over. So after 10, I had to go and see her. And as I'm leaving the apartment, Alexei gets up and he's like, where are you going? I said, well, I gotta visit this orphan who's in trouble, I gotta go. And he said, no, I'm going with you. And I said, well, all right. So he decided, he insisted he wanted to go with me. And he's from the streets, so I'm kind of concerned. I'm like praying, hopefully nothing happens. And so we're walking together in this dangerous area, kind of dark outside, of course. And two guys are asking for a cigarette. They're screaming, hey, do you have a cigarette? And I screamed back, we don't smoke and neither should you, you know, being representative of God, trying to spread the kingdom, loving people no matter what hours of the day. That was my answer. And it was not a really wise one because they started to run and chase us, wanted to do whatever they wanted to do. And so Alexi said, Max, I've got this. Something you should know about Alexi, because he grew up on the streets and lived on the streets, he had to survive. He had the survival instinct. He knew how to fight. He knew how to get what wasn't his, but he made it his own. He was a tough kid. He never had to love anybody. He never had to protect anybody. It was all about him. He was selfish and he was an orphan who had to survive. But at that moment, and I would always tell him at home, you know, I love you. Every night he would go to bed, I'd tell him, I love you. His answer was, thanks. Kind of like it didn't mean much. But then when this event happened outside, when these two guys are running at us and they're trying to get to me, they're not trying to harm him, he kind of hugs them both and holds them tightly, and they're drunk, you know, they can't do much, but as he's holding them and they're trying to get to me, that moment was to me a pure revelation that he was adopted by God. That was the spirit of adoption that just came all over him. He has never protected anybody in his life up until this moment. And that was his way of loving back, because we know God loved us first and we are called to love him back, no matter what it looks like. And that was his moment of adoption. My dream is probably what all of our ministers dream about. It's the same one, and I believe it's the dream of God, where the orphan cycle will be broken, where those who believed and were told that they are orphans forever, that mentality changes, that status goes away. And the greatest thing that can happen in that, and my dream, is for them to not live as an orphan anymore, but to have a revelation of being a son and a daughter of the Most High God, of the King of Kings, of the royal inheritance. When you have a true revelation of that, your life changes. You behave differently. You act differently. You love differently. And that's my dream, to see the orphans live in the spirit of adoption, out of sonship. And when we already see this happening slowly, one at a time, and one by one it is happening, when orphans are not wanting to be served, but they're wanting to serve. That's the first sign. They can only give if they have received. They can only love if they have been loved, if they accepted the love. And that's something we have witnessed already, and it's exciting to see where God takes it. Next, my heart has been broken more than once. As we have victories, we also have our defeat moments where we feel like God isn't with us anymore, or what happened with this? You know, you always have this question that is not answered yet. And one of the moments like that for me was, I was walking down the street of this city, and I just found a little trash in my pocket in my winter coat. And you know, I like things clean, and I wanted to kind of put out the trash out of my pocket. So I saw a huge dumpster area, and I just pulled out the little piece of paper, trash in my pocket, and I walked over to the bins and I just tossed it. And I started to walk away. It's kind of cold, so you're kind of rushing through the street. And then I felt the Holy Spirit speak to me in such a tender, tangible, quiet, yet very solid voice. You couldn't resist. And he said, go back to the dump. And I'm thinking, well, what would I do in the dump, Lord? You know, thinking, this is not God. I'm cold, I'm late, I gotta go. But I still went back to the dump. And when I got back to the dump, a couple of dumpsters, they were knocked over. And I mean, it's winter. There's a lot of snow, garbage, slush, all of this. And then I said, okay, God, what is it? And then I heard somebody moving at one of the bins. And I thought it was a dog. We have a lot of stray dogs. So I thought it's a dog or a cat or something, or a rat, for goodness sakes. Anything could be in there. And then the Holy Spirit kind of told me on just looking into the bin. And so when I looked inside the bin, I saw this little boy. And that was the moment where I knew I was looking in the eyes of Jesus. This little boy, he was sucking on some piece of plastic, paper, whatever it was. He was practically naked. It was really cold. I had a winter coat on. And I peeked in and he was just staring at me with these big brown eyes filled with pain and lost and confused. And I stared into his eyes and I said, "Hey, come out, crawl out. I'll help you." And so he started to slowly move forward, and I hugged him and unzipped my jacket, put him inside my jacket, and I started to walk away. Then I heard another noise in that, you know, dumpster area, and it was his mom. She was there. She was living under cardboard boxes, and she said, "Put my baby down." And he was about 5 or 6 years old, as far as I could tell. And I said, "Do you have a home to live? He's freezing, he's starving. Can I take you somewhere?" And she said, "This is our home, we're living here." And she just yelled at me, swore at me, threw beer bottles at me. And I said, "I'll come back to help you." And so I took him to the hospital immediately. And at the hospital, they discovered that something was wrong with his stomach. He couldn't eat. He was hungry, but he couldn't eat. And then they found that there was a piece of plastic that stuck to his wall of his stomach, and it had mold or something growing on it, a tumor of some kind. So the stomach seemed full, yet it was empty and didn't have any nutrition. And so he was slowly dying. And of course, we kept visiting this kid. We didn't know the name. He didn't speak. And we didn't have any records. I just put him under my name in the hospital. And we kept going back as ministers and prayed, and we interceded for his life and interceded for his future. And I remember one morning I showed up at the hospital and he was already slowly walking, and he got up and he would make a few steps and he would hide behind the curtain of the room. And I, for the longest time, I just couldn't figure out why he did that. But then the Holy Spirit revealed it. I was the one who took him away from his mama, for goodness sakes. I was the one who separated him. So of course I went back to try and help the mom. She didn't want to go anywhere. She didn't care about the kid. She said, "You do something with him. You'll probably be better, or he'll be better off with you. Keep him, do whatever you want." And she didn't want any help. And I kept coming back. And then one time I came back and she was already gone. She wasn't even there. And so when I, 2 weeks later, into this whole process of the hospital and this boy being in the hospital, treated and being helped and served, and we are praying and fasting as the team, and at 4 a.m, I got a call from the nurse that he had died. And I rushed to the hospital, and of course I was there for hours just crying with questions and not many answers. And my question was, "God, why? Why would you trust me alive just so I could see him die? Why would you trust me this boy just so we could witness him go away?" And something the Lord told me that really ministered to my heart, he said, "I didn't ask you to save his life. I asked you to love this life." And that's what we are called to do. We are called to represent and reflect the heart of Papa God, who truly loves. The way he loves, nobody is able to love. And that's what we do. We love. We love the one in front of us. We love those near us. We love one by one. And that's our heart. And I believe that's God's heart. It's not just about the multitude. Multitude happens out of the one in front of you.